So, first of all, the question of democracy have always been of great interest to me. I come from Bulgaria, where there is very strong ecological movement, but I got attracted to it, and then in Greece when I came to live here, after researching democracy. And I find that there is an interconnectedness between the two, for which I'll speak today. It will be more, in a way, philosophical talk. And so this is my last book, that is Direct Democracy, Context, Society, Individuality, published by Durty Books last year. And this year I'm working on another book, which will be on political ecology. And I'll try through both of these books to show this interlinkage. So I'll begin by saying that the only democracy is the direct democracy, if we stick to the etymological sense of the term, and of also the authentic form of it. How democracy emerged as concept in ancient Athens. So there were many negative aspects of the Athenian experience. So there was patriarchy, there was slavery, but despite that, these things were quite common in this period, in antiquity. What was not common was the fact that this concept that people without special skills or knowledges or even wealth can participate in the management of society. Or like C.L.R. James famously quoted the Greeks, supposedly quoted the Greeks, every cook can govern. And we see that proto-democratic institutions were not limited only to ancient Athens. There were such in the ancient Mesopotamia, where there are suggestions that the king, the monarch Gilgamesh, had to negotiate some of his most crucial actions with the bodies, deliberative bodies that were open to all adult males of the back then society. He was not allowed to do whatever he wanted. He had to deliberate with the citizens. And then there were also certain indications that certain such institutions appeared in ancient India and in the early Viking cities as well. There was an institution called the Thing, which was a form of deliberative assembly, a proto-democratic institution. In the Middle Age Slavic cities as well, there was an institution called Veche. And then in the 17th century, there were the New England town hall meetings in the North America, where the settlers from Europe managed their newly found cities through democracies, through popular assemblies. And what was distinctive of the ancient Athenian experience was the institution of the public assembly as the highest decision-making body of the society, where all male citizens could deliberate. And then there was also the institution of the sortition, or the selection by lot. That is, from all the pool of male citizens, by random, were being selected for short-term periods, and all the time recallable, revocable, people to fill and to undertake administrative official positions. So what is, in short, direct democracy, or the real form of democracy? Democracy is, as Jean-Jacques Rousseau suggests, a regime of self-limitation. This concept of self-limitation have been further on developed by Castoriadis. I will send later on a link on a piece that I have written about Castoriadis and the concept of self-limitation. So in societies like the one that we have today, which are not democratic, they are oligarchic. That is, the government is not being done by the demos, that is by the people, but is being done by elites of political experts. And the political expertise, by its nature, is a counter-democratic concept. So what we have are oligarchies. Oligarchy is a form of heteronomy. Heteronomy is a most generally said a form of societal organization in which the laws, the institutions, and the general limits to what can be done and what cannot be done within society are being determined by extra social institutions. That is, institutions which are not accessible for direct participation by all people, but to certain strata of the people. So in liberal oligarchies, like the ones that exist in Western Europe or in North America, there are certain privileges to the citizens, let's say. They can do certain things in which like more totalitarian societies cannot do, but they still cannot participate directly of the governance of their societies. On the other hand, in democracy and the so-called self-limitation, the limitations which society sets to itself are being determined by all the demos, by all individual members of societies, through various kinds of institutions which allow and give voice to everyone. In this sense, the institutions, the limitation which is being instituted by the demos in direct democracy, in one direct democratic setting, it's being derived by society itself, by its own grassroots, so it's self-limitation. In this sense, we cannot speak of various forms of democracy. There is democracy, which means power of the people to self-govern themselves, and then there are parliamentary regimes, oligarchic regimes, totalitarian, theological, and other kinds of regimes. They are not like what we have today. It's not representative democracy, but it is a representative oligarchy, let's say, but it does not have anything to do with democracy. Like every society, direct democracy infuses society with its own temporalities, or better yet, influences the social temporalities in a distinctive way. So what we have today in societies run by nation states and market capitalist institutions, the social temporality is being shaped in the following two ways. So you have the everyday level, the time on an everyday level. So the capitalist clock is pushing you. You have this sense that there is never enough time for leisure, or for that matter, for anything, especially in the age of neoliberalism and with the introduction of extreme precarity. People are being, their time is being teared apart at various part-time jobs. So their time is being fragmented and in a way is being drastically reduced. While on a grander scale, on like more long-term scale, like a year or longer periods or decade, there is this sense of what Paolo Virno, the famous Italian philosopher, calls the deja vu effect. So there is also what the status quo calls normality. So there is this sense that nothing really changes. So there can be certain events, like governments go down, comes up, like there is this grand fights between Macron and Le Pen, Trump and Hillary, pro-Brexit, anti-Brexit, and all this. But at the end, supposedly, there is this normality. There is certain social structure which will not be disrupted. What direct democracy is doing to this temporality is reversing this effect. So there is the everyday level in which by all people being able to participate directly in all spheres of life. So don't forget that in democracy, there is a holistic political approach to everything. So there is no separation between different powers, different authorities, judiciary, economy, and so on. People, through democratic institutions, control all aspects of life. So in this way, they come in a conflict. Democracy comes in conflict with both nation-state societies, where economy is being managed by the state to a certain degree. Then there is the elitism in politics. And on the other hand, of capitalism, which says that there is this distinction of the economy, which must not be disrupted by politics, especially its more neoliberal version. So in democracy, people directly control all these spheres from below through deliberative democratic procedures. So what happens is that the everyday time seems more prolonged. There is this feeling that there is much more time. And I'll give an example concrete for what I'm speaking about. There is this, because job is work generally is being distributed more equally by all, there is this sense, there is not this pressure, because all act as active managers. There is no obeyers or order takers and order givers. So there is this sense on everyday level that we have more time. And then again, on a larger scale, the political time is much more rich, as everyone are having a space in the political discussions and decision making, and society is being reshaped. New institutions are being proposed, introduced, etc. New social relations can be introduced by various communities interacting with each other and disagreeing, proposing, and finally reaching to a certain decision. And so a concrete example which I would like to give is the ZAD. I don't know if you know about it. It's an occupied piece of land in France, near Paris, where in the 50s, the authorities wanted to build a huge airport for mostly business purposes, like the transport of cargo. And the locals said, no, there is already a huge airport in Paris. There is no need for second one, which to serve the corporate interests. We need this land here. There are people that deal with agriculture, peasants, various kind of workers, and even a space for leisure. So we want this space to remain as it has. So I had the pleasure of 2 years ago having Christine Ross, a famous writer, an author from New York, United States, famous for her writings on the Paris Commune. So she was invited to ZAD, and then she goes several times on her own, without to have to give a speech. She did it voluntarily. She wanted to go back, and she was telling us that what she liked was the way that time moves. And it was exactly the exemplification of what I was saying before of the direct democratic temporality. So she was saying that because work in the ZAD was being done collectively by all participants, it consumed a very small portion of the everyday time. So there was a lot of leisure time. There was a lot of time for hobbies to be developed, for additional things and tasks and so on, and a lot of time for political thinking and deliberation. And then again, she was telling that just for 1 week of political deliberation and assemblies, the time was so rich of events. So it was very different from what she was experiencing in New York, let's say, where she, also as in her job as a scholar, all the precarity which this implies, she had like very intense everyday reality. But then again, the New York political time on a larger scale was pretty much the same all the time. So this is an important aspect. And when I speak for ecology, I think of a phrase, a specific phrase by Castoriadis, which he spoke in an interview. In one of the texts that I have linked, you'll see this reference. He says that ecology is essentially political. It is not scientific. Science is incapable, as science, of getting its own limits or its goals. If science were asked the most efficient or the most economic means of exterminating the Earth's population, it can, and it even should, provide you with the scientific answer. Science, as science, it has strictly nothing to say about whether this project is good or bad, in quotation marks. One should certainly mobilize the resources of science, research, to explore the impact that such and such an action within the sphere of production might have upon the environment, or sometimes the means of preventing some undesirable side effect. In the last analysis, however, the response can only be political. So what he wants to say to us is that ecology is not a way, a scientific way to find how to maintain the ecosystems on dialysis so capitalists can continue extracting profit. But it's profoundly different thing. It's how we collectively to set the limits that our society, our social impact will be on nature. And in this sense, it has to do with the roots of democracy, as I say before, as with self-limitation. Once again, like democracy, have to do with our impact on our social environment, to do our impact on our natural environment. So these two share the common root. And if we examine the roots of the contemporary ecological crisis, we'll realize why the two are even more interconnected than simply sharing the same root. If we trace the roots of the contemporary environmental crisis of global warming and climate change, we can reach to a conclusion which have been reached by social ecologists like Murray Bookchin, Dimitri Russopoulou, and Kurdish imprisoned leader Abdul Yocalan. They tend to disagree with the idea that capitalism as such is solely responsible for the current environmental crisis. They think that we should go deeper. And they go as deep as back in time as tracing the emergence of two things very important. Patriarchy, the emergence of patriarchy, and of gerontocracy. So it was the enslavement of the woman by the men and of the younger, and supposedly, as in today terms, of the illiterate or the person without knowledge by the older, the elders, or the people that are the people with knowledge or the today's equivalent of the technocrats, let's say. So they say that with this appearance of gerontocracy and patriarchy, a profound change of values took place in the value system of early societies. So societies up to that point were what Bookchin calls meterocentric, that is based on the revolving around the figure of the mother, of the life giver, and they were basically feminist societies. In a sense, they were in no sense romantic societies. I do not want to paint a pink picture of perfect societies, but mutual aid, basically feminist principle, solidarity, deliberation were all part of the core of these societies. With the emergence of patriarchy and of gerontocracy, new values replaced the feminist ones, and these were the masculine values of enforcement of power, of authority, of oppression, of violence. And you'll recall the emergence of the masculine figure of the warrior class, and then also the knowledgeable, the class of the elders, the shamans, and so on and so on. So with this replacement of values was given indirectly, was set in motion development of certain conditions which snowballed to today and gave the conditions of our attitude by having this attitude like you can you can impose your will on your fellow human beings, then sooner or later you can decide to impose it on nature and treat it in a similar way that you treat your slaves or your employees, etc., etc. We can even argue that the idea of enslavement and of treating of animals in a cruel way is also part of all this mindset. So, of course, this set in motion certain mindset, which was anti-ecological, profoundly anti-ecological and anti-social in a way, but with the introduction of capitalism and the logic of the unlimited economic growth for growth's sake, of course, set further conditions for the destruction of the fragile planetary conditions which make life on the planet possible for us to sustain us. It is important to note that economic growth is profoundly anti-democratic and anti-ecological. And of course, I do not mean the creation of wealth as such for the increasing of well-being of society, but economic growth as is being propagated by the governments of from countries worldwide. Like here in Greece, for example, it's every day in the news. It's like a kind of religion, the idea that we need non-stop growth, and if it stops, we are for no good. So economic growth, I should briefly explain, have to do with the incorporation of further and further commons, common pool resources, into the market economy or being bureaucratized in the framework of the state, like it happened in the Soviet Union, for example. So when they speak of we need more economic growth, means we need to incorporate further more resources into the economy as we know it, the economy of exploitation that is the capitalist economy. And be sure that there is no there are no limits to this incorporation. It can continue because some people say, okay, they'll privatize all the forests, all the seas, all the lands, and at some point this finish. But we have seen, for example, as is the case with internet giants like Facebook or Google, they have go as far as taking this growth to the level of exploiting the human existence in the internet. So it remains like a tax-free to join Facebook or to Google, to search through Google, but they make profit by your very existence in these mediums. So there is always more things to be incorporated into the current exploitative economy. So economic growth, as they mean it, it's in a sense getting all possible resources and modes of life to be to serve the current economic model, and in a sense it makes the existence outside of it nearly impossible. And I'll refer you to Latin America, South America, where supposedly progressive governments like the one of Rafael Correa in the early 2000s, and their war on native or indigenous populations. And their clash was because this progressive left-wing supposedly government saw these communities as enemies to economic growth, because what they do is they practice commoning. They share their common resources, and they have a stewardish type of attitude. That is, they treat them because they have the full knowledge that without these resources, their life is being endangered. They don't have this sense that capitalist anthropological types have, the pseudo-mastery. We think that we control nature, but we are in the dark of how vulnerable we are to even small changes, like the ones in climate, for example. So when we hear economic growth, what they mean is making the conditions for an alternative, let's say democratic and ecological society, as minor as possible. And a huge problem, in my opinion, in the social and ecological movements is that many people continue thinking within the imaginary of the current society. So, for example, there is this idea that we need like a kind of greener capitalism and shorter showers, like our individual attitude, and we don't get the bigger picture. And then there is also like authoritarian tendencies who, for example, claim that one of the main problems is overpopulation, which I argue, along with many other social ecologists, that it's an argument of eco-fascist nature. So the argument goes that what we have today, one of the problems that we are destroying the natural world, which renders the conditions that makes us alive today, is that there are simply too many people, and actually point the blame at the poorest and the more disempowered people whose voices are never being heard. So so what they do is they reproduce the logic of the national state capital complex, which says that if you do not succeed in life, it is your own fault. You did not you did not play your cards right. So now you should suffer. And it's important to see in the famous book written in 1968, the book The Population Bomb by Paul Ehrlich, who describes, who puts this scaremongering of the danger of overpopulation to the forefront again, who claims by going to India in the 60s that how many people he saw in the street, and he saw with his own eyes what overpopulation is doing to the Indian society. He goes to Delhi, and it's obvious how he is influenced by his age and by the political system in which he lives, and he sees Delhi in the 60s, which back then, according to the United Nations, had a population of 2.8 million people, and he sees it as being devastated by overpopulation, while in the same period, Paris, the international emblem of elegance and sophistication, numbered the staggering 8 million people. So we see how what he did in practice was he mistakes poverty for overpopulation. So he generalizes a common human nature, which will always lead us to destroy our environment. Well, the facts are that there are certain political arrangements which set certain conditions, which also render our attitude towards the natural and social world around us. So it is neither the capitalist, the green capitalist attitude of personal responsibility, and neither the eco-fascist one of like the need of totalitarian solution, which often can seem attractive to ecologists because with climate change, we have a certain urgency. There is this temporality that we do not have unlimited time to solve this problem out. We have to decide as quickly as possible. So they are these voices that they say, okay, what can correspond to such an urgency is a totalitarian type of political system in which a narrow elite of technocrats, for example, will know what to do and will lead us out of the crisis, forgetting that it was this logic of domination that led us to this mess in the first place. And if we accept such an attitude, we are setting ourselves to a course to do again this mistake or simply delay the ecological catastrophe which is coming, because you cannot tackle the problem of domination by inserting a different form of domination or giving more domination. So in order to deal with climate change and pollution and all the environmental crisis, it means also dealing with the social crisis which we're experiencing. And this also means finding solution to the crisis of representativity, not by reimagining new forms of political parties or voting for conservatives or so on, but reinventing democracy from below. And I think there is something profoundly democratic, but not in a determinist way, in ecological issues. And in what sense? So ecological issues usually tend to be very straightforward. So if you have a fight, like in the case of ZAD, against an airport, you either allow the airport to be built or it will not be built. There is pretty much no middle solution. Like here in Greece, in the river Achelos, in northern Greece, the huge dam is being built and local communities are fighting the complex of capital and state bureaucracies. So the dam, it will be either set in motion or it will not. So what this presupposes is a certain prolonged temporality of such issues. That is, these issues take a huge time spans or short ones. This prolonged temporality is very important, as it creates conditions for new forms of political deliberation to take place. And then again, this type of issues, the environmental ones, go across class differentiations, across ethnic differences. They tend to involve different type of communities, and they tend to place local population against the leviathan of state power and of transnational capitalist institutions. So they, in a way, put you in a dilemma. If you want to win this a certain environmental issue to protect a certain piece of land or a river or something else, you have to seek collaboration with people that you, in other cases, might not search collaboration. In this sense, they are these two elements: prolonged temporality and the need of collaboration, which create these conditions for democratic, generally democratic proto-institutions to begin emerging. I already mentioned ZAD, which developed in exactly this way. It was this piece of land which gathered plethora of movements and social groupings. Like it's famous that there is the Black Bloc, there are anarchists, vegan, feminists. Then there is more old school socialists, and even agricultural workers who are quite conservative, and all this from the midst of this environmental struggle to keep this piece of land, each of these groups for different reasons, have managed to develop proto-democratic institutions through which to coexist there and to coordinate their struggle. And it's very interesting, for example, how they have these weekly assemblies. And here to write only, it's called ZAD. And so, for example, they have dealt with the question of small-scale criminality, violence, and sexism in a very interesting way. Don't forget that this is a struggle which it's decades long. So, of course, there were cases of violence since people that were involved were educated and raised in a repressive, oppressive, and society based on domination as the current one. So there were such incidents, but what they did, for example, to solve this problem was to introduce the element of surtition. So at general assemblies, what they do is they pass a hat or another vessel with random numbers. And so people take out, and certain numbers are to be the next week's like a kind of a security group which have to deal with the cases of violence and of antisocial behavior within the camp. So there is this question, are you agreeing with that or not? Is it direct democracy? Well, I don't think that we ever had a pure direct democratic regime, but I think that it is a case that gets quite close to it. So that's why I speak about proto-democratic institutions. For example, in ancient Athens, with the development of the democracy, it is very interesting that they discovered that even in an assembly where there is no need of political expertise or a certain amount of wealth to be able to participate, that still there were people that emerged as demagogues. They were well connected in the community. They were well respected. They had certain rhetorical skills and could enforce their will on the rest of the assembly. So there were measures introduced, like a very interesting one. The rhetoras, the orator, who had the word for the moment, he had to hide his hands within his clothes, so to not articulate and to influence, so to give less body language and less influence on this level, and to enforce a certain rationality in an argumentation between speakers, so as to reduce the element of emotion, let's say. So, you know, speakers like Hitler or other people, or leaders like Trump who use their charm, for example, or certain attitudes that they appeal to broader masses, with actually speaking irrational things, and with actually huge amounts of the population not really agreeing with exactly what they say, but agreeing with their attitude. So the ancient Athenians tried to tackle this on various levels, and one of them was like to try to minimize the body language of the person. So this is not a panacea, just this one idea that on the political level, when we have to deal with the management. It's Notre Dame near Nantes. Yes, it's where that is. Yes. So another example that I would give for such a movement that incorporates social or political matters with the environmental one is the Yellow Vest movement in France. It is once again a very diverse movement, and a movement that during a prolonged struggle, which had to do, in my opinion, the Yellow Vests, one of the most important things which they did was remind us that from now on, we cannot speak about ecology in a way that puts the blame on the average citizen. So it is not our common fault. It's not all of the fault that each one of us have is not equal. There are certain people and institutions who pollute more. There are certain industries which promote a certain lifestyle which is very wasteful. So this is very important of the Yellow Vest. They reminded us that you will not get away with taxing the average person. You will find a new way to deal with climate change. And in the prolonged struggle, don't forget that it's over a year now that the Yellow Vests are in the streets, they developed a dense network of public assemblies all over the roundabouts of France where there are Yellow Vests. And furthermore, they go step ahead of what the Occupy and the Indignados and the movements of the Arab countries during the Arab Springs, that they developed these popular assemblies at squares. What they did was even a step forward. What they suggested was a kind of confederation of all these assemblies so as power to remain in the grassroots. They refused any party representation. They refused any kind of a political party of the Yellow Vest. There were, I remind you, several lists of Yellow Vests the last elections in France, which all combined took less than 1.5%. So the Yellow Vest rejected this, and instead they proposed a way of acting and of action based on democracy. I would also recall Arundhati Roy, the famous writer from India, and her magnificent collection of essays in the form of a book called The Algebra of Infinite Justice, where he describes the struggle of communities in different parts of India against large dams, which were going to destroy local ecosystems. And we're going to have a huge social and environmental impact, but we're going to enrich the government elite of the country and their business allies. So by having these struggles, many years long struggle, environmental struggle, what they developed was again a dense network of political assemblies that coordinated these communities, and they did not, again, they refused, they rejected the logic of political representation and allowing someone else to speak in their name. Or here in Greece, in the area of Epirus, this is northern Greece again, there is a huge struggle in the city of Yannina and all the area around it, against oil extraction. There is oil that will actually be very destructive to the area, as it's not that cheap to get extracted. There will be a huge environmental devastation. And local communities that are actually very conservative, what they did is, once again, like kind of organically reaching to these forms of popular deliberation. They have created a network of popular assemblies and have had several meetings of delegates of all these assemblies. And furthermore, just recently, they had kind of a congress of all these movements, but they have invited also other ecological movements in Greece to discuss an alternative energy program for the country, because they realized that their groups in Greece fighting against a huge wind turbines that are being enforced by foreign investors. And then there are also groups that fight against oil extraction. So if it is not this form of energy or that form of energy, and there is certainly no one willing to play with the nuclear energy, so what else can we think? And they reach to a very, in my opinion, democratic idea of energy. And this is striving towards small scale energy sources that are serving local communities, and they're manageable by local communities. Because when you work even with renewable energy and you work it in this business model, this centralized model, by creating huge solar plants, huge solar plantations, which require centralized management, then you create certain organizational preconditions which require certain bureaucratization. And it's the same problem with nuclear power. Nuclear power cannot be, at least for now, cannot be built on like a backyard level or a communal level, or neither its waste can be managed by local communities. What nuclear power requires is a military type of society, military type of management. And in countries where there is nuclear power, there is, to a huge degree, the military who are responsible for its protection, part of its management, etc., etc. So we see almost organically, I don't say that there is determinism in this, but there most certainly is in different parts of the planet. We see democratic demands and practices going hand in hand with the ecological issues. And I will only remind you of Rojava, a place in northern Syria, where during the Arab Spring and the civil war, which followed the Arab Spring in the country of Syria, a power vacuum was created between the government of Assad and the ISIS. And in this power vacuum, the communities of the Kurdish people in the northern Syria had already developed grassroots institutions like popular assemblies, local communes, and city councils, which undertook power and distributed it equally. And what began as a strive for ethnic self-determination through this democratic dynamics and led also to an ecological sensitivity and practices. And I will refer you only to the most noticeable one, a campaign called Make Rojava Green Again, which is a part of the political agenda of the Democratic Confederation of Local Assemblies and Councils in Northern Syria at the moment. And what they try to do is detach these communities from the oil economy, as seeing it intrinsically capitalist and centralized. And what they try to do is return to practices of permaculture, exploration of renewables on a communal level, and so on and so on. So we once again see that democracy and ecology, even when being practiced separately, they almost organically lead to the emergence of certain sensitivity to the other. And I find it hopeful that also among the Extinction Rebellion movement, the Friday for Future, and all these movements in the West, we hear also voices that speak of the need of citizen assemblies, of introducing further deliberation, of even using sortition on discussing the climate issue, because also there is something else. When we speak of democracy, we also understand it is a form of justice that we all should have a say in the public affairs that will affect our lives, in the management of the society, as these decisions will affect our lives. So we should also have a say in the way we treat nature and the fragile planetary conditions, which we are already disrupting. So the only fair thing is to involve as more people as possible. And this, and I would conclude with that, this requires for our movements to abandon ideological purity. Democracy requires the voice of everyone, the participation of everyone. And there is an important Israeli thinker, Aki Or, who have said that if you want to establish a democratic society, a direct democratic society, you cannot do it in any other way but having the majority of people in society to agree that they want it and to implement it. So democracy also, as Rousseau say, requires from the citizen to arms himself with a lot of courage and a lot of energy and a lot of patience, as it is this difficult, it is burdensome. At times it is not as heroic as the glorious spectacle of electoral politics, but at the end, it is the only way in which we can turn the whole social pyramid on its head down and introduce a feminist set of values which will make humanity act as a steward of the planet and not as its master. Because we are far from being able to fully control nature. We are in direct symbiotic, we need to work in symbiotic matter with all the complex network of ecosystems that covers the planet. And the only way to do that is to resemble it in our political way of organizing. So I will conclude here, and if there is more questions, you can write in the chat, and I'll also try to provide further links of things that I have spoken about.